Okay, but as you all know that this topic lifts quite an important topic. So we decided to arrange a special lecture to cover this one. And this topic is also included in the test, which you people are going to have in the last week of October and first week of November. Okay. So it was quite important to cover this topic. So we should start it formally. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and Assalamu alaikum to you all. Before saying salam, actually I just wanted a surety. And as now I got it that I am audible, so I'm going to start off with the lecture. But screen is not moving. Got stuck. Just wait for a minute. I need to assure that the screen is moving. This screen got stuck. Just wait for a minute, students. Screen moving. Okay. So first of all, as per convention, these are the LOs that at the end of this lecture, students will be able to define biomedical waste, and you will be able to list various types of biomedical waste and describe hazards of biomedical waste. And then you should also be able to enumerate steps in hospital waste management. That is the very important thing. And I think this quote very well describes the real situation that let the waste of the sick not contaminate the lives of the healthy. And this is so very much important. If some sick people are coming to the hospital to get themselves cured, to provide curative services is not just the basic aim. We need to be conscious that while providing the curative care, we would be generating a lot hell of waste. And this waste can act as a hazard for so many healthy people. Therefore, we should know. At least at this stage of your academic careers, you should be able to have an idea that what are the SOPs, what SOPs should be followed, and how it should be managed. Okay. Therefore, we all know you are all having your ward rotations. You know very well that what type of waste is being generated in the hospitals. Waste generated during the diagnosis, testing, treatment, research, or production of biological products for humans or animals is referred to as biomedical waste. Biomedical waste does not mean only the syringes, the sharps, or the genotoxic or the cytotoxic. No, the term is biomedical waste. It means all the cardboard which is generated, that is, we have further classified the waste. So there are some household waste, then there are sharps, then there are chemicals, there are genotoxic, cytotoxic, so the whole range. Okay, so we can broadly classify it as that in healthcare setting, healthcare waste, there are two types of waste, non-risk and risk. And the major chunk is of non-risk, like 75 to 90% of the waste which is generated in the wards is the non-risk waste, okay? And the risk waste is just 20 to 25%. And the unfortunate thing is that we are not able to dispose properly even this 10 to 15% of the waste, fine? So according to WHO classification, this is the classification, this is mentioned in your books, and you have to memorize this classification, that there is general waste, then there is pathological waste, sharps, infectious waste, chemical waste, and radioactive waste. This classification is given in your books, and you are supposed to memorize it. Why is it so important for a clinician to know that what type of waste are going to be produced? Because in hospital waste management, first of all, we categorize the waste. Why? Because the collection of the waste depends on the segregation, on this classification. We should have separate color-coded bins, or we should have separate place to store each classification of waste. Fine. Therefore, it is so very much important to know how many types of waste are there. These are the type of waste which can be generated. Again, non-infectious 84% and the infectious. Now in that infectious category, we can have a whole range of classes. Okay, these are the sources, the larger sources, the smaller sources. May it a tertiary care hospital or may it just a dispensary or a daycare clinic, waste will be generated, no doubt. Okay, and who's at risk? Sanitation workers, paramedical, medical staff, patients and attendants, and then the public. Okay, and then we need to have a good biomedical waste management in order to keep all these populations safe. Okay, and then these are the hazardous conditions which can result if this biomedical waste is not disposed of in proper condition. It can lead to infections, it can be genotoxic, cytotoxic, it can be chemical toxic, it can be radioactively hazard, and then physical injuries. Okay. Then we have just a good this theoretical part is all available in the books that how this waste is generated. I am more interested in telling you people the ways of management and how this waste is generated. We have gone through it that during diagnosis, treatment, investigation, but the point is how that waste is going to be disposed of, okay? And we know very well that these are all associated with a large chunk of hazards, radioactive hazards, cytotoxic hazards. They are infectious, okay? They can lead to spread of diseases. Therefore, then there are sharps which can result in physical injuries as well. Therefore, this hospital waste should be disposed of according to proper SOPs and not like this. Not like this, which is shown in this picture. And believe me, this is our true picture. This is what which is being happening in most parts of our country, and this is so unfortunate thing. So unfortunate. Okay, these are the rules. This was just put in here for the sake of the reference because anyone can ask that why otherwise rule is not your jurisdiction. So what are the steps in healthcare waste management? The first step is waste classification. Then comes waste segregation, handling and collection, on-site transport and storage, waste minimization, treatment and disposal. So before disposal, the safe disposal is the last step, but before that we have to pass through a number of steps. And just look at number one, I have written waste classification. Isn't it that first step should be the collection, waste collection? No. Why? The cleaner SOPs, the safe SOPs are such that waste, if we first collect it and then segregate it according to classification, it will not serve the purpose. Because what we want that all the people who are going to be involved in this process, they should also be rendered safe. Okay, so a good healthcare waste management system should first of all classify that. Let's say we have three classifications: household waste, then for the sharps, and then for the infectious waste. Fine. So we should have three color codings. In Pakistan, for household, we use the black color bins. For sharps, we use yellow. And for the infectious or the hazardous waste, we use red color. Okay, here I want to tell you one thing that in different books, different color codings are used, and in different hospitals, they sometimes also deviate that from their routine this color coding system. But this doesn't matter. we can choose the color. You can choose the color differently, but it should be notified once you have decided that this type of waste will be disposed of in this type of bin in this particular color. It should be mentioned. Okay, one thing. Next comes, then you have proper that color-coded bins. Okay, then comes the collection. So it collection, which is supposed to be the first step, but it comes at third point. Then there is the transport of this waste, and then there is waste minimization and treatment and disposal. This is just a flow chart, but you have to memorize this. Rather, if in exams, if you are able to draw this flow chart, I think it will serve the purpose because it has all the important points, like generator are the hospitals, generator of what? Generator of this waste. Then there is in-house segregation, in which we have color-coded polybags, and then there is this collection and segregation. Then there is a common storage point in every hospital. Like at Jinnah, we don't have our own incinerator, but what we have, we do have a central storage point for the waste. And at that storage point, waste has to come from every individual ward and need to be stored there. So it means that for transportation, we will be having two types of transportation: in-house, which is from the wards to that central storage point, and then out, which is from this storage point towards the incinerator. Okay, it should be approved special vehicle which should be transporting it. Unloading and temperature storage, then the treatment, whether we are going for incineration, autoclaving or shredding, and then the final disposal. And we will do it one by one how we can do it. Okay, first of all, source reduction. Source reduction is that right at the very source where this waste is going to be produced. At that very source, we should have certain ways in which we can reduce the burden of the waste. Fine. How we can do it? We can segregate, keeping non-infectious waste out of infectious waste stream. It will help us to decrease to lessen the burden on the incinerators. Fine. Then minimization, that should be, every procedure should be according standard SOPs. And this is the segregation of the waste. We should, now next time when you go to wards, you should look around that at what part of the ward this color coding is displayed. It should be displayed. And if you are unable to see this color coding, you should ask the concerned, particularly the nursing staff, that why have not they displayed the color coding system? Okay. Otherwise, as per routine, black color for household waste, yellow for the sharps, and for the sharps, it shouldn't be open bins. It should be proper cutters, which are provided at your very own hospital. These yellow infectious waste, and they should be leak proof. That is so very much important. Okay, this is the labeling. Okay, as I have told you, but as I have told you earlier, that this color coding can vary. Okay, this is another picture. But it can, colors can vary, but the point is that color coding should be displayed. Okay, this is how things are going to be stored. Okay. Then comes, first step was the color coding, then was the collection. And you know very well that if this waste is going to be collected as per the color coding, half of the work will be done. Fine. Then, and next we have to make these SOPs clearly at some point that waste should be disposed according to colors. One thing. Secondly, box shouldn't be filled more than 3/4. Okay. Sharp waste should be collected when the box is 3/4 filled only. Next, there should be, every hospital should have, because up till now we are talking just for single ward. Okay, the responsibility of the ward is just that they should classify the waste. They should have proper collecting system according to the color coding system. after that, the next thing, and then they should send this waste as per SOPs to the up till now. I just want to show you that how it is to be transported, and these are the different signs, different warnings, and you should be whenever you go towards that radiology department, you might have openly seen this sign, which is on the lower row, corner of the lower row, which shows radiation. Okay? Then there are the biohazard signs, corrosives, health danger, explosive, and you should be able to read and interpret all these labels. And this oftenly comes in